It was a dark and stormy night. A light snow was falling. Yes, it's 9:30 p.m., and baby Sammy has a 102-degree temperature and is drinking a juice box and watching Peppa Pig. Your pediatrician is on call 24/7 and open 7 days a week and has open 6 slots every day, including tomorrow morning. But your insurance company and employer has teamed up with a national for-profit company that employs docs who are complete strangers to you and your child. And they really want you to use telemedicine. And they've made it even cheaper than going to your pediatrician in your medical home. In fact, the nearby Children's Hospital also offers this service and endorses direct-to-consumer telemedicine. They all claim they can diagnose ear infections, strep throats, asthma, UTIs, without those annoying stethoscopes, otoscopes, throat swabs, and urine samples. They must be really good. Even your own pediatrician can't do that. Yes, it's our direct-to-consumer telemedicine rant. Welcome to the medical twilight zone. Over the last several years, companies like American Well, Teladoc, Dr. Direct, and MD Live, as well as adult and children's hospitals, have been massively pushing telemedicine, often with huge incentives from the insurance companies and large employers. Now, I'm sure this is an issue in adult medicine also, but today, boys and girls, we are concentrating on pediatric populations. We also think that the care of children in many adult-oriented urgent care centers kind of sucks. Or
Sucks!
You haven't seen Avenue Q.
No, I haven't.
Suck. But we're saving that rant for another day. Let's start at the very beginning. A very good place to
this
start.
This is the singing episode.
But not you, Ralph. I mean, Matt. Some definitions. Telemedicine and telehealth have become pretty interchangeable terms, so we will use telemedicine for all. Now, telemedicine is simply the remote diagnosis and treatment of patients by means of telecommunications technology. Many aspects of telemedicine are wonderful, such as when used to reach underserved populations, often with peripheral otoscopes and peripheral stethoscopes, and a live facilitator like a medical assistant. There's also subspecialty follow-up for patients who have specific diseases and a prior relationship with a specialist, which is also great.
Mm-hmm.
It's also been incredible for pediatric transports, letting the specialist at home base really see what's going on in emergency transportation, and also in ICU monitoring and hospital codes, sometimes with robots. So there's 24/7 eyes on the patients since nurses and docs can't be everywhere. And there's also starting to be telemedicine within the pediatric medical home model, where a pediatrician or pediatric nurse practitioner or PA, etc., can do face-to-face follow-up for things like ADD meds and anxiety. Although I always worry that they're not checking the weights, which can be crucial for certain med checks. Many positive advances in pediatric telemedicine have been pioneered by our wonderful children's hospitals, and we support that fully. There's also been newer experimentation with medical kiosks where there's a medical facilitator and those peripheral diagnostic devices, which is not optimal compared to an in-person visit with the doc because there's no prior relationship with the patient, but certainly is better than just doing it by phone or video alone. However, this rant is about pediatric direct-to-consumer telemedicine by phone or iPad or tablet. All of these telemedicine companies and hospitals, insurance companies, and large corporate employers give lip service to preserving the pediatric medical home. But if they really wanted to promote this pediatric medical home, they certainly would not push these services when the pediatric caregivers' offices are open during the day.
Open! They're open.
Wide open. Their aggressive advertising is obnoxious and infuriating. Our Twilight Zone opening is almost exactly how many of them advertise, although they add video of a sick child in a well-decorated bed with a worried mom looking down upon her.
Yeah, usually frowning and on the verge of tears.
And again, in all these ads, they make no mention of the pediatric medical home or calling your own pediatrician.
Never.
These doc in the phones, as opposed to doc in the box in urgent care, have no medical records of the children, no relationship to the family, and no peripheral technology, and no access to lab testing, yet claim or infer that they can treat strep, ear infections, urinary tract infections, abdominal pains, and lung disease, and they always, always, always mention their ability to call in prescriptions.
Oh, that seems to be the critical piece of these advertisements. And the thing is that we spent large amounts of our training having it drilled into our head that you don't treat what you don't know is a diagnosis. So in other words, when somebody tells you they have a sore throat, you don't just say, oh, that must be strep, and call them in some antibiotic. It's not just ridiculous. It's not just illogical. It's dangerous. I mean, dangerous with a capital D.
Now, in a 2014 meeting on direct-to-consumer telehealth in Washington, D.C., which included the AAP and the AMA, it was clearly shown that direct-to-consumer telemedicine falls short, and specifically mentioned the lack of ability to diagnose otitis media and the lack of any watchful waiting before antibiotics. All their diagnoses by telemedicine were symptom-based. These standalone telehealth providers have set a very low bar for quality medical care.
Now, Rob and I have over 50 years of experience, and while we can take pretty good educated guesses about whether a child is going to have something like an ear infection or a strep throat, it's not uncommon that we will find that the physical findings or the lab results don't match what we would have diagnosed simply from a history, especially for acute sick visits.
Absolutely. I mean, I think I'm pretty good at getting the history and kind of figuring out what I think it's going to be, but it's very common that I'll think this is going to be strep and it's not, or I'll think this probably won't be strep, and it is. And certainly I wonder then if it's a carrier state. And ear infections, perfect story. I've got a cold, screaming, pulling your ear, and you look at the ear and it looks perfect.
Yeah, I would say easily half of the children that I see in the office on a daily basis for specific ear complaints do not have ear infections. And so how this can be diagnosed over the phone by A, somebody who is in a completely different environment, and B, somebody who oftentimes is not pediatrically trained, is just unconscionable to me.
The following is bad medicine and terrible antibiotic stewardship: diagnosing strep without a swab, and these days a rapid strep, diagnosing urinary tract infections without a urinalysis and a culture, diagnosing ear infections without an otoscope exam, and diagnosing asthma and bronchitis and pneumonia without listening to the lungs with a stethoscope. Now, the adult-oriented urgent care centers are bad enough diagnosing and properly treating pediatric problems in person. By doing it on the phone, it's just awful. Now, besides poor care, a huge issue, again, is that antibiotic stewardship. My own college patients in my practice and my 20-something-year-old nieces and nephews now know they can just call telemedicine and guarantee getting an antibiotic for free by phone anytime, anywhere, through their health insurance. Now, I'm sure this overall may save some money for the insurance company's employers, but what about antibiotic overuse? We are becoming like a third world country that dispenses antibiotics over the counter. Why hasn't the infectious disease specialists in the United States raised a lot of outrage about this?
Yeah, that befuddles me also. When it comes down to being careful with antibiotics, which is really critical to their effectiveness when we do actually need them, it seems as though we really had started to be much more mindful of this when we all decided that treating a common cold with an antibiotic was idiotic. It was virally induced. But now, with just a phone call and a simple, almost scripted history, it's very easy through these telemedicine services to get pretty much any antibiotic you want.
I agree. We were making progress in this, and now we're running out of antibiotics, and the antibiotic overuse is creating superbugs. You read it in the paper every day, yet more and more with telemedicine and some of these urgent care centers, it's just opening the floodgates to inappropriate antibiotics.
Yeah, this is a brewing disaster.
Putting our money where our mouth is, our mouth where our money is. About a year ago, Matt and I wrote an op-ed article in our local paper. Yes, we love our local papers. Denouncing direct-to-consumer telemedicine and those adult-oriented urgent care centers, including specifics of how insurers and employers incentivize families not to go to the pediatric medical home, making it cheaper to use the phone or go to urgent care centers, which is the opposite of what they should be doing. Another issue is having these visits on a phone or a tablet. They can't be very sensitive to issues like child abuse and neglect. A phone or a tablet cannot replace in-person looking at the interaction between children and their families. again from everything from potential child abuse and neglect to sequela from family domestic strife. And I would think that these families are much more likely to choose a doc by phone or urgent care center who has no prior relationship to their family.
Yeah, I think here is a place where convenience seems to be vastly winning out over common sense and over good medicine. And when that's the case, we really have to question the motives and also the process.
Now, to their credit, the American Academy of Pediatrics has clearly denounced direct-to-consumer telemedicine. They state, in isolation, virtual telemedicine care represents the antithesis of quality medical care, care that is patient-centered, comprehensive, team-based, coordinated, accessible, and focused on quality and safety. Telemedicine technology for episodic care lacks the essentials of patients' medical records and disrupts continuity, creates redundancy, and increases fragmentation of care, and is an impediment to health care.
I love that antithesis.
I do too.
It's the exact opposite. It's unequivocally wrong, and yet it continues.
And they close by saying that it does not provide the same level of care as hands-on visits with a physical exam and lab tests, and again leads to suboptimal care. Now, my opinion is that when telemedicine is provided by adult-oriented docs, especially in these large companies that contract with employers and insurance companies, the care gets even worse. Again, just like the doc in the boxes, who we both have personally seen diagnose tinea or ringworm as Lyme disease.
Oh, over and over.
Strep with no cultures, and my favorite, the phantom otitis media that you see the next day and they look perfect. or they are so packed with wax that you know that no one ever saw those eardrums.
Yeah. Yeah, let alone the wrong dosing. Although we'll do a whole episode on medical aid units as it pertains to children, because it's abysmal.
And speaking of dosing, I mean, it does seem that they're using medications and doses straight out of My Harriet Lane from 1986. Amoxicillin, 125 milligrams for 5, 20 per kilo per day, divided TAD. Really? Yeah, right. Really in 2017? Mm-hmm.
If you're going to prescribe medicine for children and you're not a child specialist, at least check the references. Google it, for God's sakes. Holy moly.
That's not hard.
It's not hard.
Now, to be fair,
Rob does it every day.
To be fair, pediatricians and other pediatric caregivers seeing kids live in the office sometimes make mistakes, but not like this. In our area, big companies like DuPont, or they call themselves DuPont Dow now, partner with insurers like Aetna to push telemedicine for only $40 with the ability to prescribe by phone. Our local major adult hospital waived all charges for telemedicine with American Well, again giving lip service to primary care. Other insurance companies also make it actually cheaper to use telemedicine or urgent care centers than to see us, waiving copays for them, but never when they come to see us in their pediatric medical home. Now, I think Matt and I agree that we will happily compete with any telemedicine or urgent care center any day, anywhere, on a level playing field.
All day long.
But it is hard to compete with free.
One eye tied behind my back. Yeah, just to qualify what you said about the local hospital, I think that they offered telemedicine free for their own employees, right? Who are insured by them, more or less, right? So that was their incentive.
Okay. And the message is their valued employees deserve the best.
Right.
And
deserve the best? Wait till the doctor's office opens in the morning.
Bottom line, enticing parents with opportunities to consider convenience as a priority over good medicine is a slippery and inevitably perilous slope. A trip to the emergency room is the best place for kids with severe injuries or illnesses that are life-threatening. But as a rule, if your child can walk and talk and is interacting and playing, the chances are that whatever he or she has is not an emergency and could likely wait until the morning. There are many non-emergency pediatric complaints that do not need to be seen at night or need to be treated at night and could be handled by calling your friendly neighborhood pediatric caregiver on call who does it for free. This is exactly what the April 2017 policy statement on non-emergency care for children states by the American Academy of Pediatrics. These non-emergency complaints include minor burns, earaches, pink eye, possible UTIs, sore throats, and potential strep throats. Now, strep throat is not an emergency, and giving over-the-counter pain meds will help much more than even getting a dose of antibiotics that night. It's also not an emergency when you have a rash or mild skin infections. Most GI illnesses are not an emergency, such as some vomiting and diarrhea with mild dehydration. Also, simple wounds, foreign objects in the ears and noses, colds, coughs, and allergies.
Yeah, many of the pediatric practices, at least that I'm familiar with, now have websites that are very comprehensive. One can go on those websites oftentimes and look specifically for what the treatment regimen is for almost any illness that could be potentially treated at home. And also indicates to parents whether or not it seems like this would be something that needs to be seen sooner as opposed to later. These resources are seemingly endless now, including, again, your own pediatrician's website, kidshealth.org, which is a fabulous website. Rob, do you know of any others that you routinely will recommend?
I do like the Kids Health.
The Kids Health is really stellar.
The AAP has websites. Got to say, my practice website is not as good as it could be. We're going to revamp it.
Mine rocks.
So you've shamed me. This very latest statement from the AAP also recommends that retail-based clinics and telehealth services that are not directly connected to the medical home, plus all acute care services that lack pediatric experience, should not provide care to any children younger than 2 years of age. Amen to that.
Amen.
So call your pediatric caregiver first. We are almost always available. Now, a rant without some suggestions for change is like spitting in the wind. So here are some of our suggestions. Pediatric caregivers should talk to their families about telemedicine. Explain why you feel it's inferior care. If they've used telemedicine, ask them why and what their experience was.
I think part of the peril there is oftentimes parents have no idea what good medicine is. Again, unfortunately, people are oftentimes looking for convenience as opposed to competence. We need to explain to parents why that was a potentially risky move on their part.
Matt, I also really don't go out of my way to give advice to parents who call us wanting to know if the care and advice they got by telemedicine or urgent care meets our standards as pediatricians. I sometimes will tell them they should just call back the telemedicine docs or urgent care for clarification.
Having
said that, I usually cave in and correct any mistakes. The kids should not have to suffer.
See, I encourage people who have decided to go to an urgent care center, a medical aid unit, or access a telemedicine provider to call us in case something was prescribed that we can double check the dosing, because I would say 50% of the time it's wrong. Not only is it wrong, but it's inappropriate, or it's potentially dangerous, or potentially ineffective at the doses that were prescribed.
Right, and kids shouldn't have to suffer, but it is somewhat infuriating that we're spending time fixing the messes of others for free.
Don't blame the children for the sins of their parents.
I know. Now, here's a rough one, Matt. So if you have a family who repeatedly uses telemedicine or adult-oriented urgent care over and over and over again, would you consider telling them that you don't feel comfortable seeing the family anymore because you don't really feel like you're the pediatric medical home and they should perhaps see another pediatrician for their care?
I've never done that. In fact, it's probably not something that I would do. I'm more of a fan of trying to point out to people the potential dangers in accessing healthcare that's not appropriate for their child.
Well, for me, and I haven't done it either, but if I have a family who does this over and over again, especially when we're open, and then always calls us to double check on what happened and using our resources, I can see at some point saying, you know, I'm not the pediatrician for you if that's the way you want to have care for your child.
Right. I mean, have you run into that very often?
Not yet. I do talk to the families, but the way this is being pushed aggressively, I think that will.
Right. I think there definitely is an inherent danger in this becoming more common as opposed to less common, despite seeming voices of reason out here trying to let people know that this is not optimal for your child.
As we become the Muppet guys in the back, just saying,
screaming.
No. Pediatric caregivers such as ourselves should move towards being open 7 days a week, which both of us already do, and having some evening hours, which we both do, but on a somewhat limited basis.
Do you? Do you do it every week?
Tuesday nights now.
Yeah, so far only one of our providers does, but that may be changing in the near future. I think we have to adapt to what the current situation in the world is. People work.
But also remember that most pediatric caregivers, like us, have same-day visits every day, which is very different than the adult world in adult medicine, in my experience. If these slots get unused over time, then they're going to go away. And it's not going to be available when someone says, I want to see you. They'll say, well, how about next Tuesday? And that's not the way you should practice pediatric medicine.
We really do our double best to keep availability during the day. There are exceptions to that. I mean, especially one of our offices does struggle at times, especially on a Friday afternoon, to make all the appointments available that we'd like to. But optimally, at least, we'd like to hear from people and perhaps be able to give them a little bit more pertinent direction than just having them call a teledoc.
Now, we should encourage telemedicine operators to put their money where their mouth is and get more peripheral devices and virtual kiosks for care. We're not Luddites. We know that technology telemedicine will not go away, but they should invest more in quality care, not just history-based care. Now, parents, you should complain to your health insurance and employers if they incentivize telemedicine and urgent care over your primary care pediatric medical home. It should always be cheapest to go to your own pediatric medical home for the best medical care for your child. Pediatric primary caregivers should also take the leap into telemedicine, especially in the context of a true pediatric medical home for areas such as non-acute chronic care follow-up like ADHD, asthma, anxiety during the day, and perhaps the evening, and make sure we get reimbursed. Are you doing this yet, Matt?
No, but I can certainly see space for that in our practice. I think that ADHD, anxiety, you know, some of the things that are more behavior-based or more history-based are certainly in the realm of things that we'd consider doing. I think asthma might be a little bit of a stretch. You know, oftentimes you do want the exam there. You may or may not want to check spirometry, those types of things. But I certainly think that there's a place in a pediatric medical home for telemedicine, just not acute care by any of us for that matter, unless the appropriate peripherals are there. Otoscopes, stethoscope, for us, medical history is always helpful. And this just seems to be entirely lacking in what's being advertised to the public.
And when we do it, we know the family. We have the medical history, so it'll be much better. But I'm not doing it yet either. I think both Matt and I are waiting for Nemish to do it. He's our tech guy. He's our favorite tech pediatrician in the area.
He is. He's generally at the forefront, a guy who practices in our community who tends to explore these things for us before we dip our toes in.
So if you're listening, Nemish, get going. Which brings us to another point. Perhaps we should be charging for the free care we give by phone at night, since telemedicine seems to be able to charge $50 a call with the blessing and backing of insurance companies and players. Will they start paying us for night call? So if you're listening, Blue Cross, Blue Shield, Aetna, United, where do we submit our bills for our free phone advice at night? Should we be like lawyers and charge for every minute of phone calls for our patients? This is hard to do if you're the first doc to do it in your community, but I do have a colleague in Texas, let's call her Betsy, who charges $20 a call and tells me her families are happy to pay it. Bottom line, if the trends of telemedicine and urgent care expansion continue over the years, there may not be a friendly neighborhood pediatric caregiver left to see your child, one who truly knows your family. Many pediatricians may go concierge like some of the best internists do now. Now, I don't blame them for it, but it does further reduce the number of good primary care physicians and creates more healthcare inequality based on patient wealth. Matt and I both like our mix of white and blue collar families, suburban, urban, even rural families. I would not want to only care for the most wealthy of families.
Yeah, for some of us, it goes against a lot of the philosophy that brought us to where we are in terms of our practice anyway. For those of us who went into pediatrics to assure ourselves of an opportunity to, not to sound too cliche, but to help people who needed it, and also to be able to do that through science and through understanding. To have a situation where I'm only seeing people who can afford to be seen is just counter to what I imagine being a physician is about.
I agree, although maybe we'll have the Matt and Rob Botox Treatment Center in the future. We'll just do
Did
Botox
I ever tell you that,
that I've
thought, actually, at one point, it wasn't really a concerted effort, but one evening I was sitting around and I started to Google how to remove tattoos because I figured that was a nice way that potentially I could put my kids through college without necessarily having to, you know, get too deeply in debt. You know, we pediatricians are not exactly the at the top of the food chain there. I abandoned it, but I think it's still a valid way, you know, especially with all the tattoos, misinformed and misbegotten tattoos out there. It could be a way to make a little something on weekends.
Right. Maybe you could start with that huge Los Lobos tattoo on your chest.
Never giving up the Los.
Los rocks!
Okay, so we're going to leave you with a quote from Dr. Chad Hayes, a pediatrician who wrote an elegant article in the Washington Post about telemedicine and pediatrics. His succinct advice to parents: if you believe that your child's pediatrician is no better than your smartphone, then find a new pediatrician. Lastly, just before recording this rant, we found one more recent article about telemedicine. It seems that the big for-profit telemedicine companies like American Well, Doctor on Demand, and MD Live are having a wee bit of a problem lately on their internet video live physician interactions. Male patients are flashing the doctors. Yes, patients are showing their junk. Now, I had to laugh. Now, we are not condoning this behavior, but we know that this would never happen during telemedicine with us in the pediatric medical home. Why, you may ask? Because if our patients did this, we would call their moms.
We have the number.
Quickly. All right. That wraps up our rant.
So stay tuned as we wrap up season one with our next podcast on strep and earwax. What a combo. If you like this podcast, please make sure that you tell your friends. We're always looking for new listeners. And also consider rating us on iTunes. We love fives. Hopefully we're amusing you and informing you at the same time. Say goodbye, Rob.
Goodbye, Rob. Productions, all rights reserved.